was prominently described by the New York Times and other major media. 60 Minutes, in case you missed it, there was a segment on these two scientists, and the title of the show was described as Collateral Damage. And basically, the government is conducting these espionage-related investigations and crimes, and they happen to be in the way. That's how I understand what collateral damage would be. Now, New York Times also had an editorial, and it's very unusual for a major newspaper to come up with an editorial about these two individuals. And basically, the Times concluded these two individuals deserve an explanation or an apology, and they were receiving none. So what are some of the things that were happening at the same time? You're here on Capitol Hill, and the Congressional Asian Pacific American Caucus was one of the earliest ones that took note of this pattern of prosecutions, and they held the first press conference related to these issues back in May 2015. And these are two pictures. One picture that was taken at that time, and I don't know if you know Stan Shives, many of you should know him, because he was the PAPA representative there, along with Congressman Ted Lieu and at that time Congressman Mike Honda. And KPAC, over the last 2 years, has done quite a bit. They have held press conferences to call out these issues. They have written many letters, including this one with 22 congressmen, and this one including 44 congressmen. It's a joint letter basically to the Department of Justice, basically to the Federal Bureau of Investigations, as well as the Office of Inspector General in DOJ, Department of Justice, to call for investigations, independent investigations. In budget hearings, KPAC Chair Judy Chu has called for an explanation, or else it would have impact on the budget. There were many public speeches given by these congressional people, and also since October of 15, for more than a year, that we have held bi-weekly conference calls with concerned citizens, with interested organizations, and Albert, I think he has to leave for a tour of the Capitol. Albert is one of the recipients of these conference call results. So APAPA has been involved from the beginning, and here is the congressional participation. The U.S. Commission on Civil Rights, they have also written letters and basically calling for the DOJ and FBI to provide explanations and conduct full and independent investigations into these prosecutions. Community actions, many letter writing jointly by many different organizations, press conferences. Here it was in 2015 and Aaron Fox. Online petitions that includes Nobel Prize laureates, educational seminars, and here is one that's conducted jointly by Committee of 100 as well as APAPA, and here's another one that was conducted in DC immediately after Professor Xi's case was dismissed. Fundraising, both Sherry Chen and Professor Xi have established legal defense funds trying to battle the legal cases. And also street rally. And this is where I had the great opportunity and honor to work with both Vincent and Michelle, who in middle of March, okay, held a big rally in front of the courthouse where Sherry Chan's hearing was taking place. At the end, you would say, with all these actions, there has to be some response from the government. But this is the limited response that we've seen so far. And this is coming from DOJ, Justice Department, and FBI. And basically it says on Sherry Chan's case, the reason it was dismissed was to exercise his discretion to dismiss the indictment without prejudice. Okay? So that's not much of an explanation. On Professor Xi, it was due to information that became available after the indictment, and therefore proceeding further would not be in the interest of justice or consistent with the principles of federal prosecutions. Again, it's, well, I was a bureaucrat, so I know what bureaucrats talk like, and this is bureaucratic talk. Now, in terms of bureaucracy, you would say, hey, Office of Inspector General is something that's established so that there is an independent channel to look into the potential wrongdoing, or at least investigate whether federal departments were doing the right thing or not. Well, a lot of letters were written to the Office of Inspector General, but the response is that they do not have the jurisdiction to investigate. It turned out that DOJ is one of those exceptions. They have something called the Office of Professional Responsibilities. And this is something very different from any other federal department. And then at this point, all those congressional inquiries have been referred to the Office of Professional Responsibilities. And so far, we haven't heard anything more, okay, in the last 18 months. So that's what has taken place in the last 2 years. And a quick update in terms of Sherry Chan's situation. She was terminated a little bit more than a year ago by the National Weather Service, and she filed a complaint. And if you have seen or heard from Sherry Chan, she's a feisty lady. She's not going to take what has happened to her sitting down. So she's filing an appeal, and that is to the Merit Systems Protection Board. Because she was a federal employee, she cannot jump into the judicial process right away. There's a whole set of administrative process that she has to go through, and one of them is this MSPB. And she is filing an appeal based on three reasons, causes. One is wrongful termination, two is racial discrimination, and third is unlawful retaliation, in the sense that even though her criminal case was dropped, they're still trying to retaliate with administrative actions. So the hearing was held in Cincinnati, Ohio, on March 14th to 15th, and the hearing actually continued for another 2 weeks because it did not end, and it required video conferencing to complete it. But at this time, a decision is expected, anticipated in the next month. It may come, it may not come, but it will be a precedent-setting decision, one way or the other, in this situation. These are some of the pictures that took place in Cincinnati back in March. And remember, I think Vincent and Michelle will remember, it was sub-freezing temperature. It was cold, it was windy, but look at all the people who showed up with signs lined up in the courthouse in support of Sherry Chan. And this is people of all background and creed and race, and including Sherry Chan's former colleagues in the National Weather Service. And it was covered by all local television and print media. And here's Vincent leading the charge. Here's Michelle responding to TV interviews. And so I would say, in terms of Asian American history, and in Cincinnati, Ohio in particular, this has to be history setting in many ways, right? So this is the kind of reactions and support that have shown. And some of these people actually flew in from California, from Indiana, from Boston. So it's not just local Ohioans, but basically from around the country. During a hearing, it was revealed these are some of the principals in her case. And it's interesting what has happened to them in some ways. Here's the person who basically started the investigation about Sherry Chan. And her accusation is that we have a Chinese national, okay, working in the National Weather Service, and she is passing information to China. And this is apparently how the investigation got started. Here is a person who is the deputy director for National Weather Service who did not meet, did not discuss the matter with Sherry Chan, and yet started action to terminate her after the criminal case has been dropped. And now she has moved on to the acting deputy director of the Census Bureau, my old stomping ground. With the 2020 census coming up, which is so important in terms of civil rights, in terms of federal fund allocation, and everything that depends on numbers in terms of federal programs came from the Census Bureau and will come from the Census Bureau also in terms of redistricting of congressional districts. So this is very important. And yet we have a weather person who is now leading the Bureau at this point because the director resigned 2 months ago and the deputy director left in January. And she moved to the Census Bureau in December of last year. So in 6 months, she's now leading the Census Bureau. Here's the director for the National Weather Service. For whatever reason, he recused himself. He's a scientist background, but he said, I don't want to get involved in this. And that responsibility was passed on to Devaney, Admiral Michael Devaney. And he approved the termination action, and he retired 1 month after the action. So many of the principals involved in the case, they're no longer there, okay? So that's what typically, in many ways, what can happen. Now, we're still waiting for the MSPB decision at that time, but be assured that there'll be follow-up actions, whatever that decision says. And then there's the update for Professor Xi. And last month, he filed something called a Bivens action. So this is going to be in civil court, and it's against the lead FBI and other agents last month, okay? Now, federal employees enjoy something called immunity, and that is in the carrying out of their duties, they're exempt from criminal charges. But in this particular case, we are talking about Bivens action. In general, what it says is that a violation of someone's constitutional rights, and in particular the Fourth Amendment rights, then by the federal officers, then it can give rise to a federal cause of action. Now, I'm not saying that this is going to be easy. There have been, not been many precedents, but there is a course of action that Professor Xi is also not sitting down and taking what he has faced, and he's fighting back in terms of filing this lawsuit. So he may also follow with additional claims under the Tort Claims Act, and he has been very active. And he has been very active in saying that this is a situation that is not just for the benefit of himself or his family, this is something that he has to do for the Asian American community. And he has been on talking tours. He was in Capitol Hill in December of last year, and he was in Georgetown Law School a week ago. And these are his topics of a discussion, the usual suspects, bias in government surveillance, and I'm not a spy, a personal account that he spent 20 minutes, and I think that will be clipped pretty soon, that will be presented in public in terms of what he said in those 20 minutes. And I describe it as extremely stirring, that it really gives you a concise description of what he and his family, and in particular his 12-year-old daughter faced, and yet he's going to take some action to try to counter what he faced at this time. So his lawsuit has 5 complaints: malicious prosecution, unlawful search, seizure, FISA orders, warrantless surveillance, and then the property and belongings. These are all Fourth Amendment grounds. The Fifth Amendment grounds would be equal protection and due process violations. Again, the complaint is available online, so if you're interested, all the information presented here are publicly available. It depends on your interest, whether you want to pursue it more. What I want to point out here is, what the heck are Pfizer orders? Okay, how many of you are aware of them? Including looking at this Washington Post article this morning. What are warrantless surveillance? What's wrong with that? Do you have any problem with warrantless surveillance? What does it mean? Okay, this is where I get into the broader topic about constitutional rights. And a little bit background, in case you're not aware, what is FISA? And then what is Section 702? Now, this is necessarily a very simplified, concise summary, but it should give you enough idea what it's about. FISA stands for Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, and it was passed in 1978 in the aftermath of Watergate. Well, what happened to Watergate? Besides President Nixon resigning, it was also revealed that there was a lot of domestic spying. And FBI was spying not just on foreign agents, but also domestically on people like Martin Luther King, okay, and other entertainers going back to Charlie Chaplin, John Lennon, okay, Albert Einstein, scientists, entertainers, and the blacklist is more than 20,000 people. And guess what? There are Chinese names on it too. So in the aftermath of all that became public, then FISA was passed so that it offers some judicial congressional oversight. It forbids domestic spying in the name of security. Okay, you just can't say Martin Luther King is a national security threat, therefore I need to watch him. Okay, that cannot be an excuse. You have to have probable cause and reason. There is a FISA court that would approve, review and approve surveillance, and it's limited to only 1 year. It requires probable cause and also specific location, how you're going to do the surveillance. And surveillance will only be targeted to foreign powers or agents of foreign power. And it also imposes something called minimization, and that is whatever information the government collects, there has to be constraints, restrictions on how the government can use the information. This is FISA going back to 1978. And it went on for 20 some years without any problem until 2001. One significant event in 2001 was the 9/11 attacks. And with the 9/11 attacks, the Bush administration became based on questionable executive authority. It's not even an executive order, because an executive order you have to document. Okay? And here's something that used presidential authority that started these programs. And that started with all the monitoring of the telephone, email, and any electronic communications on millions and millions of Americans. Okay? This is all done in secret. And in 2008, when the Trump administration was ending, and then a new president would be coming in, and then Congress, working with the White House at that time, basically started to legitimize FISA. So in 2008, there was a FISA Amendments Act that tried to legitimize the secret programs, and it adds something called a section or chapter 7 in Washington jargon is really called Title 7, right? So within Title 7 or within Chapter 7, there's something about Section 702. And within 702, these are some of the brief descriptions. One is it restricts targeting only to the communications of non-US citizens. Non-US citizens would include citizens and residents and legal entities, like a company, like a business. So it's only for non-US persons outside the US. That's the restriction. And it cannot intentionally target US persons inside the US. And it must, and this is explicit in the law, that it must protect privacy and civil liberty under the Fourth Amendment. This is written into the statute, into the law. So in 2008, one thing that most people miss, including many of the Congress people, senators and representatives, who passed the law, and that is the scope was expanded. Originally, under 9/11, the target was Al-Qaeda and any associated terrorist groups. But in 2008, the scope was expanded to include the conduct of the foreign affairs of the U.S. Now, I challenge you or anyone in Congress or any lawyer, what is the conduct of the foreign affairs? What does that include? A better question yet, what does it not include? So this is a very broad scope, okay, that went from Al-Qaeda and terrorist groups to foreign affairs of the U.S. Soon after this, then the DOJ and the FBI began the campaigns that economic espionage is second only to terrorism and China is the main threat. And in 2015 alone, the espionage investigations conducted by the FBI increased 53%. And that's at least in the doubles. This is also a national secret. You know, how many cases are there? Well, can't tell you. If I tell you, I have to kill you. That kind of a national secret. But the speculation, or when you put various literatures together, we're talking about hundreds at least, at the minimum. So, in terms of the actual prosecutions, a Committee of 100 white paper recently reviewed that before 2008, the number of Chinese cases or involving Chinese individuals, this could be Chinese national or Chinese American citizens or residents, tripled. It was 17% before, and now it increased to 52% after 2008. The Pfizer Amendment Act was set for 5 years. It expired at the end of 2012, and at that time it was extended with few discussion, okay, for 5 years, and therefore the current version will expire December 31st of this year. In 2013, all the materials that I've described here became known, and that was due to Edward Snowden. He made a big revelation, he went to Hong Kong, he's now in Russia, and he made a lot of disclosures, including, instead of intentionally targeting US citizens or US residents, the government has actually been collecting information incidentally. Okay, we didn't intentionally collect, but it happens that we collected the information belonging to many millions of Americans without a warrant. There are two data collection programs called PRISM and Upstream, the massive secret data programs that are carried out without any warrant. PRISM is direct, okay? They basically went to Google, Microsoft, Apple, all the major IT companies are involved and basically obtain data directly from the companies. Your emails, your pictures, and Upstream is more indirect, and that is in the transmission of all the electronic information, it's through the backbone where the US intercept all the electronic information. So in 2013 and thereafter, through various revelations and investigative reports, up to now, and this is what this article is about this morning, we still don't know how many Americans are swept up in all these activities. It was promised 6 years ago that there will be some estimate coming out. It doesn't have to be exact. Is it in the hundreds, in the thousands? Just basic estimate. As of today, it has not been released. And in fact, through recent congressional hearings, it's basically described as, we don't have it and don't expect it anytime soon. Okay, so there will be no estimate coming up on how many people are being swept into this. And I'm going to use just some key terms. I'm not going to into any details about them because this is a whole different language. OK? Okay? There's something about data collection. There's something about backdoor search loopholes. And through these loopholes and through the data collection, any confidential attorney, client, or doctor, patient type of information are also included, again, without any warrant. Okay? So they're being collected. There's something called parallel construction, which basically says you collect data on one thing, but you can use it to prosecute for another thing. And in the paper, hopefully you have seen something about masking and unmasking. That's part of those minimization procedures. And if you follow the news articles, this is something that is huge in the Congress right now. The President, the White House is involved, and both parties are discussing this in many different ways, although the headlines may say different from Pfizer and also Section 702. And the bottom line is that there is a totally different set of language that would say one thing while meaning quite another. And these are quotes from some of the reports. So continuing to 2016, a Pfizer court opinion was issued. And this was a secret document. It's 99 pages, but it was recently declassified in April of this year. And basically, the conclusions are pretty damning. One is that the agencies have been found to have many non-compliance problems for over 5 years. Now, the government may call it non-compliance, but other people have called them illegal surveillance. So it's up to you, your perspective on what terms to use. The government reporting efforts have also been lacking in institutional candor, okay? And they represent a very serious Fourth Amendment issue. Now, this is from a court that since either 78, when the original Pfizer bill passed, or 2008, when the amendments were added, that it has approved over 99.5% of the government. So, request. So this has been described as a rubber stamp court for Pfizer enforcement. And yet, this court comes up with this kind of conclusion. And again, this report declassified with redacted parts are also available in the internet and available to the public. So what has happened lately, and also described in the Post article this morning, a bill was introduced. 1297 was introduced only a couple weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, and that is to make Title VII and the entire FISA permanent. Now, what does this mean? Well, it's right now expiring on December 31st, so whenever it expires, there has to be some debate, there has to be some discussion. Do we look at it again? What are the successes? What are the failures? There are some discussions. But if a law becomes permanent, that means there won't be any discussions anymore. And I draw the parallel with this about this Chinese Exclusion Act. Some of you may be aware that in 1882, this was a temporary law for 10 years. Well, in 1892, it was expanded and extended for another 10 years. And yet the next time when it came to 1902, it became permanent. And at that time, most of the senators and the representatives basically think it's a trivial, routine thing. So why don't we make it permanent? And it became permanent for more than 60 years. Okay. Now at that time, Asian Americans, Chinese Americans in particular, did not have any political power, did not have any political participation. So there was no argument from this segment of the community. And yet that's what can happen. Okay. Now, on June 6th, this is a bill that was introduced. So the challenge is there between December 31st, between now and December 31st, what will happen to this bill? That has, in many ways, suggested its violations of our constitutional rights, as well as its impact on Asian Americans and Chinese Americans. So, from my personal perspective, we have four choices. We either let it go, this is not important to us, this is not of interest to us. We can support the bill and say, let's make it permanent. We can say, let's support the expiration of the statute, let it end. Or finally, support the reforms and reauthorize it. But this cannot happen by itself. Okay? None of this one can happen by, except the first one, none of the others can happen by themselves. So it requires some community participation and action in deciding what is the best thing to do here. And quite frankly, given all the push that have been coming from the intelligence community, this is not a realistic option at this time. It's not going to expire, okay? So it's a question of, do we let it go? Does it become permanent? And in fact, do you make reforms before reauthorizing? So here are a few of my personal thoughts. Again, we didn't have a chance to participate in the debate about Chinese Exclusion Act, but we do now, okay? So my suggestion is we can't sit this one out. Some Chinese Americans have already suffered damage because of the stereotype image of perpetual foreigners and suspicious spies, and we always, when it comes to issues like this, we're always on the forefront, and I can give you all the historical examples of what has happened. This is also an issue not just within the Asian American community, because it's fundamental and dealing with constitutional rights, and this concerns all Americans. We share the importance of national security. I don't think anybody would dispute this, but I don't think we can continue to be collateral damage or scapegoats or simply victims of racial profiling and reacting to things when they happen. It's also very important to me that the justice system here must punish the guilty, but it must also protect the innocent, and especially for us, the Asian American. We're not alone in this, and if you look into the internet, there will be many organizations, there are many individuals who have challenged this, who have filed lawsuits, who have sent out fact sheets, and basically recommended the various kinds of reforms. But at the end, we're going to bear the consequences of our actions or inactions. So what can Asian American organizations and individuals do? At the minimum, I think it's important that we be aware of these issues. We have to voice our concerns, participate in this legislative process, and I'm glad that I'm participating in this civic leadership forum to discuss this particular topic. So at this point, I'd like to close. I'm not here to bash the United States. I've been here for 50 years. There are many things that I like. But again, the United States is not a perfect nation. And we can make it more perfect. And it's through our wisdom, through our participation, through the participation of its people. And Asian Americans are part of this people. So with that, I thank you. And this is my presentation.